Namaste, a very good evening and warm welcome to all our participants, members and esteemed guests and our esteemed speaker for the day. My name is Rukman Singh Rathod and I welcome all of you to the third day of the webinar organized by Kautilya Center for Public Policy on Decoding the National Education Policy 2020 from its very conception to the execution. Now, before we proceed any further, I would like to request all our members and participants to please put themselves on mute in order to ensure that our speaker does not go through any disturbances. With that said, I would now like to have a quick recap about the last 2 days of the webinars that we here at Kautilya Center for Public Policy had organized. On the 2nd of September, we had Professor Arvind Nathu, who conducted a session on the journey, philosophy, and principle behind the National Education Policy. Yesterday, we had our esteemed speaker, Dr. Padmavati Ji, who conducted a session on the structural insights, talking about the policy at its surface level. And today, we have yet another very esteemed speaker with all of us here today. Our esteemed speaker for today is Professor T.V. Kattimani Ji, who would be speaking on the academic institutions and financial autonomy vis-a-vis the National Education Policy 2020. Before I invite sir and I ask him to take over, I would like to give a quick brief introduction about sir. Sir is the Vice Chancellor of Central Tribal University of Andhra Pradesh, is the former Vice Chancellor of Indira Gandhi National Tribal University. He is the President Board of Governors, G.B. Pant Social Science Institute. He is a member of National Education Policy, HRD Ministry, Government of India. Sir has also received a lot of awards, including the Vagdhara Navratna Award in the field of education in the year 2018. Sir is also somebody who has a lot of publications attached to his name, including various publications in forms of research articles, in forms of books, in the field of education as well as policy, written in various languages. If I go on to give a long list of Sir's accreditations and laurels, the list will go on and on. Sir is somebody who is very accredited and has plenty of laurels attached to his name. With that, I would now like to request our esteemed speaker for today, Professor T.V. Kattimani Ji, to take forward. Sir, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Sabko pranam. Good evening to all. It's my pleasure to interact with you all about academic institutions, financial autonomy, vis-a-vis NEP 2020. I express my heartfelt thanks to Kautilya Center for Public Policy, Pune, for inviting me, and it's they have given me a subject of challenge. We can debate weeks together on the topic. And in fact, NEP has deal with the subject. If you want to change the country, then change the education. It is a very popular saying in the world regarding education. We need to change the scenario of our nation. We need to change the way of thinking about education, the way of thinking about knowledge and work. How the knowledge acquired should be turned into workforce, applicable to workforce. How our primary schools, middle schools, colleges, universities, and research institutions should think about our own environment, our own nation, our own villages, our own country domains where maximum people are working like agriculture, maximum people are working like skills, life skills, hereditary skills. Our education, primary education, should give us the alphabetical knowledge as well as numerical knowledge first. The student, the girl, the boy must be able to freely express their emotions, their feelings, the barriers which they are facing, the problems which are every day they are looking in the classroom, looking in the textbooks, looking in the deliberations of the teacher. They should open their mind, heart, and they should be ready to work. This is the goal of National Education Policy 2020. We should anticipate the future and imagine the unthinkable. The pandemic has created many avenues, has shown many avenues, opened many avenues to think. Yes, these are the areas where we never applied our mind, applied our workforce. And now this is the time we should think about virology. We should think about a clear, potable water. We should think about cleanliness. We should think about the food grains, which are traditional healing factors along with them. The millets were earlier part of our food system, part of our Bharatiya food system. You know, we opted some food system now because of that we are facing today. The study system, the Guru Shishya Parampara, the holistic education pattern, we should go back to our roots. These are the points where NEP speaks about and where NEP stress about that, yes, we should adopt all these things. The importance of Guru should be re-established in our Indian society. Guru is supreme, and student should follow the teacher. At the same time, that Guru must know what is the need of the hour, what is the need of the nation, what is the need of the society, how I can make my student more knowledgeable, more workable, more skill level. This is how NEP wants to change the mindset of our society. We must think, we are forced to think, yes, education is basic thing. Education is most important thing. So primary education should be given in mother tongue. In the primary itself, we should give some skills, some life skills, some skills of our own ethos, some skills of our own habitat, so that the children must learn these skills very easily without any effort. These skills will definitely make the children more efficient, more respectable, and more they can rely on their own strength. They can work hard, they can learn many things. That is how carpentry, that is how goldsmith, blacksmith, that is how pottery, that is how tailoring. Now they are more important life skills, more important skills from where we can make a successful society. We can create a more pure society where skills are available with the graduates, with the students, with the girl students, with the boy students. This is how NEP is talking about. Please anticipate the future and imagine the unthinkable. And accordingly, the textbooks, the teachers, and the students, and the environment of the school, colleges, and research institutes must be changed, made available so that the students, the researchers, the scholars can think about their own society, their own life values, their own tradition, their own medicinal system, their own agriculture system, their own water preservation system, hygienic system. And by doing so, we are going to create a more healthy society, more knowledgeable society. With these few introduction, the organizers has given me a subject regarding academic institutions and financial autonomy. NEP speaks about academic institutions, especially higher education institutions, and their academic liberty, academic autonomy, administrative autonomy, and financial autonomy. Administrative autonomy is also equally important. The institutions, the government institutions or the private institutions, should be given freedom to make their own administrative system, to conduct administration smoothly. A proper autonomy, freedom should be given to them so that they can make their own stream, they can make their own administrative values, where they can create their own administrative ethos, administrative practices. By doing so, they can run their institution very smoothly. Academic freedom, academic autonomy is also equally important. NEP speaks about, stress about academic autonomy so that these autonomous institutions, they can frame their own syllabus, they can frame their own syllabus according to the habitat of their own area. The skills can be made, the skills can be adopted according to their geographical need, according to their geographical capacity, geographical activities, geographical economic activities. They should have freedom of their own syllabus. At the same time, they should have financial freedom also, financial autonomy also. Financial autonomy, there are many activities of financial activities in a higher education institution, like funds from government, funds from other agencies, funds from NGOs, funds from CSR groups, and funds from fees collected from the students, the donations. They should be, that the institution should be able to cater their needs. At the same time, the money received and the funds spent should be readily available in the public domain, should be ready to check, should be ready to support, should be ready to question from anybody that what is that, how you are going to spend, how you have collected. Or sometime, yes, you must go to the another source where funds are available. These researches needs to be supported by the particular funding agency. The vice versa, there are many plus points to be more open, to be more honest, to be more in public domain. One of the areas where the control Raj has badly affected the overall progress of India is the multiplicity of controls on higher education. This paragraph I have taken from the deliberations which NEP has had with the institutions, with the private institutions, with the government institutions, with the NGOs, with the other institutions, charitable institutions, where people always talk about the multiplicity of controls on higher education. These areas, control Raj should be controlled. NEP has made a clear vision. Now, in the future, from tomorrow, in the future, there will be no control Raj because you have surplus autonomy to rule, to frame, to collect, to spend your own money. The need for autonomy in higher education arises on the grounds of academic expansion, excellence, and innovation too. The important types of autonomy, as already I have said, administrative autonomy, academic autonomy, financial autonomy for the programs and courses run through the institutions. The NEP 2020 envisions an increase in public investment in education by both the central government and all state governments to reach 6% of GDP at the earliest and reach 20% of all public expenditure over a period of 10 years. So this is how the public and private partnership, the charitable institutions, the public should participate in the growth of higher education through supporting financial support of higher education. The NEP 2020 states that out of the total budget in higher education, at least 2% will be earmarked for research and innovation. Now, higher education is followed by research. Without research, there is no scope for higher education. Higher education and research should be properly funded. At the same time, research should be at least 2% will be earmarked of the total budget of higher education for research and innovation. Innovation is most important. Innovation and research. Research should be supported by innovation. The innovation and research should be supported by society. The innovation and research will be always should be helpful to the society, the problems of society, which society is facing. So NEP has suggested 2% of total budget research and innovation. This is most important factor regarding a more progressive step regarding the finance of higher education, research and innovation in higher education. Our research and innovations are extremely good. Even the private sector is also competent in research and innovation. Now NEP speaks about the more fund to everybody, the government sector as well as private sector, a semi-government sector should be supported because these innovations and researches are going to make India more skillable, more self-reliant. The NEP 2020 has identified the following key longer-term thrust areas for financing to cultivate a world-class education system. Number one, expanding and continually improving early childhood education. Number two, ensuring foundational literacy and numeracy. providing adequate and appropriate of resourcing of school complexes. Fourth one is providing food and nutrition, breakfast and midday meals to the children. Investing in teacher education and continuing professional development of teachers. Revamping colleges and universities to foster excellence and cultivating research. Revamping colleges and universities to foster excellence. It is the number of colleges, number of universities they are going to be, the universities will be collected and colleges will be now work together. Naturally, the number of colleges and universities will come down, and we have to cultivate research. As we all know, we have bottlenecks within higher education institutions should be addressed. Higher education cannot attain autonomy in real sense, be it financial or academic. To illustrate, delays in disbursement, insufficient funds, huge paperwork, and the difference in conception of goals between faculty and administration played a source of tension for the faculty, severely hampering their academic freedom. This is everywhere in state governments or in central funded institutions, even in research institutions, we can easily, it is noticeable, one can see that how teaching and non-teaching staff are fighting each other because of teachers has to go for academic excellence and non-teaching staff should go for academic administrative excellence. This is how we should go for the tussle between these two groups they have created bottlenecks. We have to solve these bottlenecks, the problems, and that the non-teaching staff should be properly trained. And at the same time, teachers, researchers also should be trained in the financial matters, how to prepare, how to prepare the budget, how to prepare the project, and how to obtain the research materials, and at the same time, how to submit financial bills and accounts. The proper way we have to train them. At the same time, academicians should have freedom of academic, but at the same time, they should also learn the delicacies of financing. Joshi in 2009 quoted Goodman Harris, the then director of the International Institute of Educational Planning, Paris, noted the tasks of the agencies funding higher education institutions. Number one, achieving ever wider and more equitable socially inclusive access. NEP speaks about equity and inclusiveness in education, primary education, as well as higher education, even in research. Maintaining institutional support for teaching and research in the face of a declining unit of resources. Responding to demands for transparency and greater accountability for institutional effectiveness and equity assurances. Responding appropriately to student-based funding. See, responding appropriately to student-based funding. The number of students, the number of researchers, the number of projects should be countable, should be seen by funding. More students, more researchers, more projects, the finance should be well supported accordingly. Responding appropriately, managing institutional performance in relation to performance related funding models. This is how NEP has taken all these things. Performance in relation to performance related funding models. The institutions which are doing performing well, they are good in research, they are good in the progress of students, they are very good in the employability of students, the workmanship of students, finance should take care of such institutions. Meeting the challenges presented by private and commercial providers and developing that facilitate lifelong learning, Joshi in 2009 has said. The teachers must be ready to learn lifelong. We teachers are lifelong learners. And by learning this now, at the middle of pandemic, we should be, we have prepared ourselves for online platform. Earlier, it was not possible. It was not possible to accept the online platform. Now we have accepted. At the same time, the adaptability of technology, the adaptability of environment should be also percolate to the subject, to the problems of the society, the domain where chances, employability are more and effectiveness is also more. Time is ripe for fresh thinking on the implications of autonomy to institutions providing higher education institutions. In the year 2014, Swaminathan said this. Time is ripe for fresh thinking on the implications of autonomy to institutions providing higher education. Now, NEP has accepted, recommended that higher educations should be given financial autonomy, administrative autonomy, and educational autonomy too. It is interesting to note that one of the important representatives of NAC was ready to admit that most of the colleges and universities do not have enough autonomy to take their own decisions. This is the opinion of the NAC peer teams that institutions, they are unable to take decisions. The head of the institution is unable to take decision what is good and what is bad for their development, for the welfare of their own students, for the welfare of the girl students, for the welfare of the poor students, the welfare of the tribal students, for the welfare of the students from most hard places, hilly areas, the academic head is unable to take a decision. This is the opinion, this is the remarks of peer team committees. The government rules and regulations rather slow down the speed of progress in higher education institutions. Now, NEP has a firm decision that the speed of the good institutions, the development of the best institution should be supported by the government, central government, state government, and regulatory bodies too. Many institutions find it difficult to comply with the directives and conditions of multiple regulatory authorities so much so that it has become a Herculean task. Yes. So, NEP thought of all these things. Now, these multiple regulatory authorities will come under an umbrella where a single window will play a most important role and a fast delivery of decisions. State-owned institutions like the IITs and IIMs have considerable autonomy that non-funded private institutions do not enjoy such autonomy. This is the fact. NEP has taken care of these things. Now, private institutions has ample opportunities, freedom to go for their developments and projects and plans. The standard of government universities will improve only when governments see the need to detach themselves from management control and empower universities to be financially responsible and academically respectable. We need to establish macro level governance systems based on the principle of trusteeship rather than micromanagement that only stifles creativity and initiative. We need to believe that principle of trusteeship should be encouraged. The administrator, the academic administrator, the vice chancellor, or the registrar, or head of the department, or the dean, they should have a trusteeship, and the government, central government, state government, and the society, as well as regulatory authorities, should respect the trusteeship. Since many matters of higher education are in the state list of the Indian Constitution, the state government should also take policy measures to complement what the center proposes to do through the budgetary announcement. This is very delicate issue. State government and central government, the decisions of UGC, the decisions of MHRD, the decisions of other bodies should be taken care of by state governments, and so that the development of institutions, maybe government institutions or private institutions or semi-government institutions or institutions run by NGOs, institutions of national importance, will go smoothly. Any effort towards transforming India could call for well-developed structures and systems in higher education that would allow for reaping the benefits of autonomy. Autonomy will be going to give a responsibility to the administrators. Autonomy, at the same time, it is going to sanction them on their shoulders that you have a responsibility also. You have social responsibility, you have national responsibility, you have a responsibility of poor, you have a responsibility of gender equality, you have a responsibility of people who are deprived of benefits, educational benefits, social benefits. So we educational institutions, educational administrators should know, yes, we should get freedom, we should get autonomy. At the same time, we will get a package of responsibilities, social responsibilities, national responsibilities too. At the same time, potential departments should get more funding. In, for example, there will be 20 departments in a university. All 20 departments may not excel. Maybe 5 departments, 6 departments may be doing extremely good. The funding of these most forwarding departments should be taken care of. Potential departments should get more funding. And the graded autonomy, graded financial autonomy, which was earlier, Niti Aayog, said about this, we have to take it up. NEP has taken these issues. The institution which is doing well should be funded very supportively. The institution, some departments of a particular institution are doing extremely well. These departments should be taken care of. By doing so, the financial autonomy, the financial support, the financial benefits of the institution, and at the same time, the financial responsibility of judiciously spending, judiciously distributing and taking care of the value of the money, is the responsibility of the academic administrators of such institutions. This is how economic autonomy, financial autonomy is given to educational institutions. At the same time, we have the NEP has made, NEP 2020 has clearly said, these institutions who will get the autonomy have their own social responsibilities too. This is how academic institutions and the research will be funded, supported by Government of India, CSR funds, and as well as state governments, and some other agencies too. This is the responsibility of the institutions, should take care of their autonomy, should be respected properly, judiciously. They should spend their money on the development of their departments who are extremely doing well, the teachers who are excelling in the research, the teachers whose research is more applicable to the society should be properly supported, funded, and the extension of infrastructure, support of infrastructure, administrative should be taken care of by the institutions. This is how NAP has given ample opportunities for ample freedom to higher education institutions to develop their own curricula, develop their own model of administration, and to get funds and spend judiciously on their development projects. With these few words, I will just conclude my presentation, and house is open for a discussion. Thank you very much. Thanks for invited me to talk about financial autonomy of higher educations. Thank you very much. I extend my heartfelt thanks to you all. Jai Hind, Jai Bharat. Pranam.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Professor Katimani Ji, for those very valuable insights that you shared with all of us here today, sir. Sir, some members of the audience, some of the participants have certain questions that they have put forward, and they would like to direct those questions through me. So, sir, if you have a few more minutes, I would like to ask you some questions that our participants want answers.
Sure. I will be happy.
All right, sir. Sir, one question that we have received from one of the participants is that is with respect to considering the commentary on the national education policy itself. The biggest and the most fundamental question would be about the funding of the policy. So how do we fund it? This is one of the questions that was sent by one of our participants. On the how do we fund the national education policy?
Honorable PM has announced already. The Honorable Education Minister has spoken on multiple bases regarding the finance of NAP 2020. Crystal clear that central government is ready to finance the National Education Policy 2020. At the same time, the respective state governments will also support. This is, in fact, the whole Indian society is ready to support NAP 2020. Thanks to Honorable Prime Minister and our Vidya Mantri, they have cleared there is no problem, there is no dearth of finance money to support NAP 2020 to implement Rashtriya Shiksha Niti. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Another question that we have from the same participant is that the national education policy itself is not a law, but rather a framework for creating laws. So what do you think government should do in terms of legislation to enable various aspects of the national education policy?
I do agree with you. It is a framework. But the whole August House knows that many frameworks accepted, converted, declared as law. For example, the nomenclature of Education Department, earlier it was Ministry of Human Resource Development, now it is declared by the Honorable Government of India that it is Department of Education. It means the execution, the declaration, acceptability from government, it is already on move. It is already on the way. So this framework has become law in many ways. It is part by part. It is very wise enough that some the most very simple recommendations without much more financial problem and implications, government immediately they have accepted. Other even some laws, some chapters which have financial implication, government is ready to accept. It means this framework is going to be a law. In some cases, it is already a part of law. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Those were the only two questions that the participants had put forward. Thank you, Professor Katimani, for sharing your valuable insights with all the participants of the Cotillier Center for Public Policy. With that, we have come to the end for today's webinar. We are approaching the end for today's webinar. On the parting,
I would like to ask a question to sir.
Definitely,
sir. Please.
Sir, as we were having the institutions used to fund like TechWhip and all to the various institutions. So with respect to this NEP, is Government of India has planned certain schemes and all? Is there something framework is there in the mind now?
Yes, there are recommendations regarding EQIP also. And where there is ample of progress and opportunities, definitely NEP will come to their risk. And NEP, the recommendations framework of NEP is in nutshell. Now, we, the society, we, the institutions, we, the academic administrators, should define them properly. And government, luckily, thanks to the acceptability, ready to accept mental status of Government of India, the government is, they have opened their doors, their windows to accept suggestions, and definitely they are going to accept it. I hope so. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Believing that there are no further questions, I would now be giving my concluding remarks and also telling our participants and members about what we have in store for them tomorrow. So tomorrow on the 5th of September, the auspicious day of Teachers Day, we would be having a panel discussion on the human resource development, national development vis-a-vis the national education policy. The panel is going to consist of three esteemed speakers, namely Sri Sunilji Ambekar, Anirban Sarkarji, and Dr. Omkar Rai. Also, please note that tomorrow's webinar is going to be conducted at 5 p.m. in the evening. And I will be welcoming all the participants and members of the Cotillier Center for Public Policy and all the other guests who have joined us here today to please attend the panel discussion tomorrow. It's going to be very insightful, just like today's webinar. And with that, I thank each and every member who was present here today attending this webinar and listening to our esteemed speaker here today. Thank you on behalf of the Cotillier Center
for Public Policy
for joining us. Thank you.
Pranam.